You might say we're living in an extraordinary time. It's a whole new world on the brink of a new era of possibility. It's all here. We just need to look around. A world where self-driving cars take us safely where we want to go. A world where we can fabricate custom solutions right where they're needed. And to fantastic result. And even redefine possibility. Where we can send robot photographers to visit faraway planets and learn more about our far-flung universe. All of these advances are brought to you by, enabled by, and reliant upon data. We are living in an extraordinary time. A time when we not only can imagine a whole new world, we get to help build it.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome back Roger Anderson.
Hello, welcome to day three general session. Hey, you know, we're doing really good on our goal, or all of us are doing really good on our goal of 7,000. We need a couple more. So we're in between 6,500 and 7,000. We get to 7,000, we're gonna donate $7,000 to the International Federation of Red Cross and Red Crescent. So that's the tweets with a hashtag NetApp Insight. Feel free to do so during this session. So, if anyone is not thoroughly enjoying themselves this week, you're really doing a good job of hiding it. I just think the buzz we talked about on day one is still here. So, personally, I'm just having a fantastic time. Having a lot of great conversations with people, visiting Insight Central. Had a customer come up to me last night, just unsolicited, say, you know, I flew a long way to get here. This is my first Insight. And I really appreciate what NetApp and partners and sponsors are doing for us. This is well worth my time to be here. Thank you very much. Now, I couldn't have scripted something better for a customer to say. So I hope all of our customers are having that experience here. It's really been fantastic. You know, let me just attest, are you having a good week so far? Can I get a little bit of noise here? All right. Thank you, thank you. You know, we can't have Nito being the only guy getting the crowd to make noise here. So yesterday I said that today, well, tomorrow would be a special day. Today is Certified User Day. And it's, you know, there's a lot of pride in being, having NetApp certification. In fact, you know, I ran into a gentleman this morning I saw last night. I said, hey, did you stay out or did you, you know, did you get back early? He said, no, I had a certification test this morning, so I wanted to make sure I was ready. Did you pass? I passed. Congratulations. Then he said, actually, I have to go get my Cisco certification a little bit later in the day, too. So for all of our NetApp certified users, can you just stand up and just take a quick round of applause if I could get you to do that? I know we have a lot in here. I'm not seeing people's there we go. Ah. Very good. And congratulations, too. Something to be proud of. All right, so, you know, yesterday, I think Jeff and Nito set a pretty high bar. You know, I talked about the Nito love meter got pegged, and great response from the audience out here. Today, we're gonna do a demo, fantastic demo, but it's more about what's in the future. What you saw yesterday was something that you could go back and make work today. So today, we're gonna give you a little taste of something you'll be doing sometime in the future with NetApp technology. Yesterday we talked about the 3x guarantee. I want to just kind of pull back a bit and say, you know, for all the customers and partners who gave us feedback and how to accelerate our flash sales, thank you. We listened, and now just to, you know, put a bow around what we talked about yesterday, we now offer 3x performance guarantee, 3.8 terabyte triple level cell SSD support, 40% pricing and form factor reductions with premium bundle included, new 7-year warranty, and free controller upgrade program. It's quite a bit to maybe remember as you walk out the door. All those details are up on our website, so please go check that out. And again, thank you for the feedback. I think we listened, took action on it. Now I've got a great offering for you. So coming up later in the program, we're going to have our incomparable NetApp founder, Dave Hitz. He'll be out here to share his thoughts on some of the next big trends and why NetApp is so well positioned for tomorrow. He's going to talk about innovation. He's going to talk about what to expect from us. But now let's get started with the first part of the session today. It's my privilege to introduce our first guest speaker. He's not a NetApp exec. He's not a NetApp partner, not a sponsor. He's a physicist. It's a little bit different. He's a former editor-in-chief of Wired magazine. And prior to Wired, he was with The Economist for 7 years. He's been at the forefront of the drone revolution. In fact, he founded DIYdrones.com, and he co-founded 3D Robotics. He's here to tell us the somewhat unlikely story of how all that came about and how it's impacting the world of data. So please join me with a warm welcome for Chris Anderson.
Thank you. So I'm going to have to tell you a story about a life through data. I was inspired by the stats I saw up there about what's going to generate the huge amounts of data that are going to fill our servers and the clouds in the future. And so many of these sources and massive amounts of data are scientific. I was actually thinking back to the history, which I'm going to tell you a little bit about today. But I started my journey through big data as a failed physicist. I was trained in computational physics in the early 1990s. And in those days, we were at the big physics accelerators. I was at Los Alamos. And that was the only big data game in town. The physics machines were generating huge amounts of data, and we were analyzing them on supercomputers. And as it happened, that, I thought, was going to be my career. That failed because the accelerators became too expensive. And the only one really continuing is here in Europe, LHC in Switzerland. But that moment when we had the first glimpse of, it doesn't sound like a lot of data now, but they were terabyte data sets, and we had supercomputers, and we were using statistical methods to analyze them, and then we were sharing that data, that was the glimpse of the future. As you know, that's where the internet got started, connecting physics laboratories. That's where the web got started at CERN, a physics laboratory in France and Switzerland. That's where big data techniques got started, and those physicists who had to leave physics because the funding ended for the laboratories then went on to Wall Street, which was the next big data opportunity, and then went on to build the modern internet and web. And so these techniques we're talking about today actually started in the scientific world, and what's really thrilling about it is how they're spreading beyond science, that now everything's a big data industry. And now every part of our world has the potential to be measured, digitized, and then analyzed. And so I'm going to tell you about one aspect of this world that you may not have thought about before as perhaps one of the biggest big data opportunities ever. And it starts with my own sort of journey from physicist to then I was an editor at scientific publications, and then at Wired, writing about the march of technology. And then I had lots of children, and I tried to get them interested in it. And so we started with this. It's Lego. It's Lego Mindstorms. Quick show of hands. How many people here have played with Lego Mindstorms? Terrific. So you probably have children, and it's really cool. Now, I have 5 kids, and I'm trying to get them interested in science and technology. And a problem is that it's very hard to impress them. They're like, Dad, We've seen transformers. We don't want stupid robots that roll slowly against the wall. What would be cooler than that? And so I thought, well, what if the robots could fly? And I literally Googled flying robot, and the first result was drone. And I'm like, huh, drone. I guess that is technically a flying robot. Then I Googled drone, and the first result was autopilot. And I thought, I guess that's the brain for the plane. So I wonder what that is. And I Googled autopilot, and there was a lot of math. So I sort of stopped Googling at that point. And I asked the kids, you know, let's build a flying robot. And so here it is. Here's the autopilot for the flying robot. It's just Lego Mindstorms with different sensors. It's got accelerometers, gyroscopes, magnetometers, and a Bluetooth connection to a GPS module. And so that's what a dad and his kids put together on the dining room table when they Google flying robot. And then we put it in a plane, and it worked, sort of, a little bit. It kind of flew, not terribly well, but it flew. And the kids were bored. They were like, okay, whatever. They went back to video games, and I was stunned. I thought it was absolutely amazing that I could, like, literally Google flying robot, take some toy parts, stick them in a toy airplane, and build a autonomous drone. And today, actually, that drone is in the Lego Museum in Billund, Denmark, as the world's first Lego unmanned aerial vehicle. So I was like, what is going on? What has changed in this world that makes it possible for a father and his children to Google and put together toy parts and make something that the military considers like export-controlled advanced technology? Something in this world has changed. But what? I wasn't sure. So I kept thinking, and so I created a website called DIY Drones. And this is 2007, and people started suggesting, you know, different kinds of code and different kinds of processors and different sensors. And then more people came along, and they said, this is amazing. Can I just buy one? And so I thought, well, I guess we're going to have to start a company. So here's our first factory. This was my children. We pay them with strawberries and juice. The first production line, a couple lessons, do not put the six-year-old on quality control. That didn't work out well at all. This is what we were making. It was a robot blimp called Blimpduino because it used the Arduino computing platform. Those are pizza boxes. A very important lesson, by the way, if you choose to start your own company with your children as the factory workers, is that the worst thing that can happen is that they will actually be popular and sell out. Because then you have to ask the children to do it again. And they just won't do it again. They sold out. I said, okay, kids, fantastic. We have it hit on our hands. And they're like, there's no amount of strawberries and juice that will get us to do that again. So I said, I have to find someone to help me. So I found a guy on the internet named Jordi Munoz. He was the smartest guy in our community, our DIY drones community. He was flying a helicopter with a Wii controller using Arduino and Kalman filters and all sorts of things I didn't know about, but he was posting the code and showing how to do it. He seemed to be the guy who really had figured it out. So I never met him, but I reached out to him and said, hey, you know, I need someone to make the boards for me. Will you do it? And he said, sure. And so here he is. This is our second production line. This is in the garage of his house. When he sent me this picture, I thought to myself, gosh, he's quite young. What I didn't realize, he was actually 19 years old and a high school graduate living in Tijuana, Mexico. And I thought, well, okay, that's a little unusual that I started a company by accident with a 19-year-old Tijuana kid. But he seems to be doing a good job. And he sends me more pictures. He says, here, I've got a new space. And I thought to myself, that's amazing. He's got shelves. That is so professional. And then he sends me another picture, and he says, I got more space. I bought some pick-and-place machines from eBay, some used ones. Pick-and-place machines are these robots that make circuit boards, and some reflow ovens and stencil printers and some CNC machines. And I'm thinking, what just happened here? I hadn't met him yet, so I thought I should go down and meet him. It turns out that if you're going to start a 21st century aerospace company with a co-founder, you actually do want a Tijuana teenager for three reasons. Number one, Because he was a teenager, he had this instinctive sense that what was going on in the world of technology. This was in 2007. This was the key year where hardware got interesting. You know, if you were paying attention to, you know, the kind of the weak signals, the disturbance of the force, the glitch in the matrix out there, if you're paying attention to the trends in technology, 2007 is the year that you suddenly wake up. Now, for everybody, it was something different. For me, it was Lego Mindstorms. That was the year it came out. For some people, it was the Wii controller. That was for Jordy. It was the Wii controller because it had accelerometers in it. And it's like, what are these cool sensors that you can like move and measure motion? For some people, it was 3D printing. That was when the RepRap project started here in Europe. For some people, it was Arduino, the open source computing platform, which also started here in Europe and Italy. And for more people, it was the iPhone. That was the year the iPhone came out. And the iPhone had in it all of these sensors, ARM core processors, these bits of hardware components were suddenly becoming incredibly good and incredibly cheap because of the economies of scale of the smartphone industry. And so what we saw in 2007 was this moment where the web's innovation model of open source and community came together with the beginnings of desktop manufacturing with 3D printing and CNC and things like that, and this extraordinary revolution in smartphone components, MEMS sensors, Wi-Fi, GPS, cameras, batteries, ARM core processors, and suddenly Moore's Law was moving faster in smartphones than it ever had in any other technology industry. Now, what a 19-year-old from Tijuana knew was that there was something cool going on in hardware. Now, he didn't know, you know, that 2007 happened to be the year. He just happened to be paying attention in 2007. But teenagers are paying attention to these weak signals in the technology trends and seeing what's cool and spotting it burble up from the grassroots. The second thing that made him great is because he was 19, he was fearless. He didn't know that teenagers are not supposed to build factories. He didn't know that you're not supposed to buy pick-and-place machines from eBay and download the manuals from Google. He didn't know that you're supposed to have degrees and education in like industrial engineering to build a factory. He didn't know any of that. He was fearless. And the last thing that makes a 19-year-old from Tijuana the right person to start a hardware company with is that Tijuana happens to be the Shenzhen of North America. That's where people build electronics factories. So if you want to build Facebook, get an undergraduate from Harvard. You want to build a factory, a 21st century aerospace company, get a kid who grows up in a factory town because they know how to make stuff. And so that's what he did. And they kept sending me more pictures. This is the first clean room in Tijuana. You can't see it from this picture, but one of the things that really impressed me was that the workers are now wearing smocks with our logo. And because they're sophisticated about electronics, they're carrying these, they have these electrostatic discharge cables, these electrical cables that catch static electricity, and so they clip themselves on to the machines so that static electricity doesn't ruin the boards. So when I shared this with my friends, on Twitter, people looked at it and they saw the cables connecting the workers to the machines and they're like, oh my God, you chain your workers to the machines? Really are an evil capitalist. And then he kept going and built a modern electronics company. He's still, at this point, he's like 22. So I thought this was kind of amazing. It kind of happened completely by accident. I'm still like the editor of a magazine, and my little hobby has gone horribly wrong and is now turned into this like Tijuana Drone Factory, which, by the way, is a great name for a band if you're looking for one. Tijuana Drone Factory. So I'm like, okay, this is something. I was right that 2007 was the right year. I was right that that smartphone technology was going to disrupt industries around the smartphone. So wearable, you know, the Fitbit people, they also got started with a Wii controller. Internet of Things, autonomous cars, smart homes, and drones, all these things, even desktop manufacturing, are all spin-offs of the smartphone industry. And so what we're seeing here is that those components were starting to transform and disrupt industries around it, and drones just happened to be mine. I stumbled into it, but there it was. So we raised venture capital, and we started really ramping this up. I quit my job and at Wired, and you know, today these are just some of our facilities you know, around the world. So today, the company's about 2.5 years old, about 300 employees. We are the biggest drone maker in America, make more drones every week than all of America's aerospace companies combined. This is crazy. It should not be possible for a magazine editor to basically quit their job and become the biggest drone maker in America in 2 years. But that's what's happening now because the smartphone approach is disrupting industries. The people who come from like the aerospace industry where they think that drones are just planes minus pilots are stuck in the past. Where the people who think that drones are smartphones with wings or propellers are populating the world. So what are these things for? This is the big leap into data. So it happens because the drones came out of the smartphone industry, there's some intrinsic smartphone-y things about them that changes the way we think about drones as an extension of the internet. They started with just simply flying robots. Then they were flying robots controlled by phones because they use the same technology. And then, of course, because the phones are connected to the internet, they're drones that are connected to the cloud. And so this notion that drone, phone, and cloud are all part of the same platform, and that you can do computational tasks on the drone, on the phone, or in the cloud, or all three simultaneously, that stack approach, that full stack approach, is what changes the game. By thinking of the drone as an extension of the internet, not as an afterthought, but built into the stack from the very start, you end up with this intrinsically big data, cloud-connected approach, which is going to create the biggest big data opportunity I've ever seen. So I'll talk a little bit about what exactly these drones are going to be doing. The drones we make are look like this. This is called Solo. But on board, there's a Linux processor, as you might imagine. There's lots of processors, but the main one's a Linux processor. It can do computer vision. It's got a standard camera, a GoPro, but it can have other cameras, infrared cameras, more industrial point-and-shoot cameras, other sensors, sonar, radar, LiDAR, things like that. But the point is that it's a general-purpose computing platform in the sky with a lot of sensors and a broadband data connection down to the ground. Okay, now, once you realize that it is a general-purpose computing platform with a broadband connection to the cloud, you start thinking about, well, what industry are we in, really? So I just want to show one other picture from my past. This is my favorite book when I was in high school. It's an author named Flannery O'Connor. And the book is good, but the title is what it's here for. It's called Everything That Rises Must Converge. And I think one of the lessons of the world today is that we're seeing convergence of technology industries. We're looking at smartphones, as a trend, but underneath the smartphone trend is what's going on with MEMS sensors, and what's outside the smartphone trend is what's going on with the cloud. And then when you look at the Internet of Things, it's really also part of the same thing. So when you look back, what are the big trends going on? Well, there's MEMS sensors, there's extending the internet to the physical world, there's things like Linux, and then there's the big data approaches. And so the way I thought about it was really like this, that there's smartphones are a big meta trend. Linux is a big meta trend. Drones are a meta trend, and in our particular world, there's something called ROS, the Robot Operating System, which is an academically focused way to take academic research in robotics and use them in these more consumer contexts. And each one of these big trends has their own communities, their own technologies, their own companies. But if you recognize that you're all part of the same thing, you can start to make choices about what kind of platform you want to build. And if you're going to choose between operating systems, why not choose Linux? You've got a huge community there. If you're going to use, if you're going to choose between two processors, why not use Snapdragon, the one used in smartphones? Because there's a huge community there. And likewise for your computer vision algorithms and your big data algorithms, by looking at where the industries are converging, you can figure out what's already been done, how you can bridge to another community that's already doing the work that you want done. And so what we realize is that the drones are really right at the center of this. And that by starting to look more like a smartphone and using conventional Linux techniques, using the increasing computational power available to us on the drone, phone, cloud, our job would get a lot easier. We wouldn't have to do it from scratch. So this is the kind of stuff that we're gathering with drones. We start with really simple things, like just taking lots of pictures and then creating 3D models in the cloud by computationally extracting the geometries from the pictures. We just look at the same image. We just take look at the same object from different perspectives, do feature mapping across those images, and then look at the difference in the foreground and the background and establish the geometries with the parallax effect. When you go further, you start to get these photorealistic models. This is just a GoPro looking at with one circle around a building using a GoPro and the Autodesk technology in the cloud. So this looks like a video game, but this is actually just what a drone scan looks like. Press one button on your phone, and it automatically gathers the right imagery. No, you're not flying it. It just automatically figures out which pictures to take and then takes them to the cloud. So that's pretty good, but those buildings are easy to scan. There's no trees around them. They're relatively simple. But for more complex bits of the world, you need to have more sophisticated scanning methods. And so the approach here we use is the one that you see on phones. So if you have an Android phone, you probably have this seen this 360 spherical model or this panorama model where they guide you into taking the images that are necessary to create the panorama or the spherical image. And what it does is it just, you take a picture, and then it sort of creates a dot, and you move the camera till you get the dot in the circle. And this notion of human-computer interaction, the computer guides the human into gathering the data necessary for the computer to do its job. So in a sense, the computer is running the operation, and the human is doing just what the human does well, which is, let's say, moving a camera in space. So we use the same approach with drones. Here's me scanning a building, and what I'm doing, this is a visualization of the mission. I'm walking around the building, and the drone's above me. And what the drone does is it goes up and down and takes the pictures it needs to get the scan. And all I do is just walk. My body is the controller. Now, why am I walking around the building? Well, because there's telephone lines and trees and obstructions. And so because we don't have perfect sense and avoid technology, my job as a human is simply to make sure that it's safe, that the area is clear. The drone, in the same way you move the camera when you're doing a panorama, my job is just to kind of look up and make sure that the area is clear so the drone can figure out how to get the right pictures for the scan that it needs. What I ended up doing was scanning this. So this is a more complex structure, and you can see that we had to get underneath to look up, as well as above and look down. And this required me just to walk around that path. So there you have an example of what's called a guided scan. And now you're starting to see how robots and humans work together really well. Now, today, I need to be in the loop. I need to walk around the building to be that human safety pilot. But that's only because we haven't gotten to the next level of innovation where the drone has better sense awareness than I do. The drone obviously doesn't blink. It doesn't fall asleep. It's got more cameras than I have eyes. It can see in all directions. It can see in multispectral dimensions. It can see at night. It can see with LiDAR and radar. So ultimately, it's just a matter of time before I'm not required at all. And what gets really interesting, once you take the human out of the loop, is you break the one-to-one correspondence between cameras and people. So the question is, how are we going to get millions of drones out there? Well, we already have millions of drones out there, but how are we going to get tens of millions of drones out there? Well, we don't have tens of millions of pilots. There aren't tens of millions of people who want to fly these things. The way we do it is to go from one to one to one to many. Drones are ultimately going to be like the new satellites. They are just going to be autonomous, fully autonomous sensors in the sky that are scanning the world the same way that we scanned our own human behavior on the internet. We're going to be measuring our planet on a scale and resolution we never had before, and we're going to be doing it by having drones do it on their own. We're talking about autonomous cars on the roads, but those are still carrying people. These are autonomous drones in the sky that are simply cameras that are surveying or doing missions, covering the same thing every hour, every day, so that we can start to measure the planet and then manage the planet. We've done such a good job on the screens, measuring our behavior on the web. But the rest of the world hasn't been measured. We've started with things like Google Street View and satellites, but satellites have very poor resolution and aren't covering most of the planet. Google Street View is controversial and only here on the ground. Most of the planet's not measured, and as a result, we're not managing it well. So I'll talk a little bit about how we can start doing that. One of the examples we use is science and conservation. And this is just one example of what happens when you put drones in the air and start to see the world the way a human can't. In this case, we're working with endangered species. And these happen to be orangutans and chimpanzees. One of the important things you do with endangered species is count the population. But it's really hard to do without disturbing them. You can't see them from the ground, and you can't get into the trees. But it turns out that from the air, you can spot their nests. Every night, chimpanzees and orangutans build a new nest in the trees. Those nests last for about 30 days before the weather breaks them down. And the nests look like this from the air, and it's actually quite easy to spot. They're brown against the green tree canopy. So what you do is when you understand the nest decay rate, which is about, they decay in about 30 days, you just send drones over, you count the nests with computer vision, you discount by the decay rate, and then that tells you how many chimpanzees or orangutans there are in that region. It's a really easy way to do population counting for endangered species. Now, the great thing about it is that we can now do it automated. We can actually look at hundreds of square miles. We can use computer vision to spot the nests, and we can do population samples in an hour that would have otherwise been entirely impossible. These are just computers spotted those nests, and they can also even spot the age of the nest based on how big they are and start to do more accurate population counting. So that's one example, but we can do more. This one is spotting endangered bats. Now, the way you spot bats is with the sound they make. And you may ask, how is it possible to hear the sound of bats at night when the drones are so loud? And the answer is that the bats make a sound at a different frequency than the drones, and we can just filter out the drone propeller noise and spot the bat calls. So again, think of drones flying over forest canopies at night, listening for bats and calculating the population that way. Another example of what robots do really well that humans can't do at all. A last example is illegal logging, deforestation. Deforestation is a huge issue, but it's extremely hard to spot from the ground. If you look at this one right here, this is a illegally logged area, and you can see they left a little sliver, a little outline of trees along the water and along the roads. So you can't see the deforestation from the ground. They leave just enough trees in those accessible places so you can't see the logging behind it. But from the air, it's super obvious. Now, why don't they use satellites? And the answer is that the satellite resolution is terrible. Typically, the satellite imagery is as much as 30 days old, and this is what Landsat looks like. You know, those blobs on the side. You can't see deforestation with traditionally available satellite imagery. But the drone imagery is 3 centimeters per pixel. That's more than 300 times better than the typical Landsat you can see. In this case, it's 3 orders of magnitude better than the Landsat imagery. So, and what's best about it is that it's real time. You can send a drone up and see and scan the forest every day if you want, and you can spot the deforestation, the illegal logging, while it's happening. So you can go in there and stop it, rather than a month later, at which point it's too late. So this example, these are just what we're starting to see, the use of drones to measure the world. And once we measure the world, we can manage it. These are places where you want anywhere, anytime access to the sky, where you want to put sensors up there that are cheaper than satellites, that are above the ground, that are easy to use, that are inexpensive. This stuff is exactly what robots are for. And because they're close to the ground, they're very flexible. You can deploy them where they're needed. You don't have to put up a constellation. So I wanted to end with just a reflection of another kind of historical look back, but just a reflection of how much we've advanced in this notion of Earth observation. When I was a kid, I grew up in the space age. And the big thing when I was a child was satellites and rockets. And this image here, taken in 1972, was the first image of the planet as a planet. This is called the whole Earth image, and it was taken from one of the Apollo flights. It was the first time we could see the whole planet and actually think about managing the whole planet as a planet. Not local pollution, but rather global climate change. We now had the ability to look beyond countries and cities and really think about planetary environment. So that was enabled by satellites. And this is what the world looks like from drones. Instead of this, so the global perspective is fantastic, and that's what satellites are good at. But the problem is that sometimes you also want the aerial perspective, but now you want modern data acquisition techniques. These are farms in the middle of America. As you know, they're circular because that's the way the spraying equipment goes. It goes in a big circle. And the three up at the top are just the way it looks like to the naked eye. But the one on the bottom left is the way it looks to a drone. What it's done here is it's just taken a traditional camera with the infrared filter removed, and now you can see what's called normalized differential vegetation index. It's basically the ratio of the near-infrared and the visual. Now what happens is that healthy chlorophyll, healthy plants, reflect the near-infrared and absorb the visual spectrum, whereas unhealthy plants reflect both. So if you can measure the ratio of those two spectrums, you can actually see something you can't see with the human eye. You can see the health of the plants. Now, if you can see the health of the plants, and you can also see, by the way, the moisture in the soil, if you can see these elements of soil and plants, you can start to recognize that what looks like one crop is actually a variety of different crop conditions. And that rather than treating it all like one crop with the same amount of fertilizers and pesticides and herbicides and fungicides, instead, you should do what's called precision agriculture. You should apply chemicals and water appropriately for the needs of that pixel, or that area, rather than treating it all like one size fits all. And so that data has now been reduced to these squares, and those squares reflect the granularity of the spraying equipment. And so now it tells you, now it tells the sprayers to spray, you know, more fertilizer in the red and less in the green. And now you're ending up using less chemicals on the crop, you're using less water on the crop, and you're getting a better outcome by simply measuring and then managing. So this has always been possible from an airplane, but it's too expensive to do. It's not possible from satellites because they don't have the resolution. It's the kind of thing that's only really economic to do from a drone. And so this is just a start of being able to kind of move beyond the kind of one-size-fits-all model, the open-loop model of agriculture, where you spray a lot of chemicals in the environment and on our food, and you overuse water because you don't have information, and now starting to close the loop, measure, and then you can manage. Use less chemicals, use less water, get better outcomes simply by closing the information loop. That's what we do by putting sensors in the sky, and that's what we can do easily and economically with drones. Fast forward from the 70s, when we first put satellites in the sky, to the late 90s. You may remember this. This was a huge debate in the late 90s about the future of mobile communications. We had launched some satellite constellations. One was called Teledesic, one was called Iridium. Iridium had 64 satellites and could cover the planet. And there was a lot of debate about what was the future of mobile phones. Would it be satellites, which had ability to kind of cover the planet with only 64 satellites, or would it be cell phone towers, where you'd have to put up hundreds, well, millions of towers, perhaps even hundreds of millions of towers to get the same coverage? Now, at the time, it seemed obvious that 64 satellites was a better option than a million cell phone towers. And yet, as we know, history proved that that was wrong. History proved that a million cell phone towers made more sense than 64 satellites. When you think about it, why was that? Why does it make more sense to put up millions of cell phone towers than 64 satellites? And the answer is really instructive when you think about measuring the planet and drones. The reason that cell phone towers beat satellites is that they scaled. Those satellites were designed for voice telephony. They were designed for making phone calls. And as we know, mobile communications quickly went to data. And the data demand was insatiable. There was really no limit to the, once we had data, we wanted more data, we wanted faster data, we wanted it in more places, we wanted it with less latency. The satellites didn't scale to the data deluge. So the satellite networks made sense in a world where voice was the only use of mobile communications, but the cell phone towers could expand to these new use cases of broadband data. And because they were on the ground, you can upgrade their technology very quickly. Because they were on the ground, the latency was very low, unlike the space, which took as much as a second sometimes, to depending on where the satellites were. And even better, because the cell phone towers were close to the ground, we could subdivide the space, subdivide the spectrum, to be able to kind of, you know, just reach more people over the same spectrum by just putting more towers place and chopping it up. And of course, because the towers could be put where the demand was, there was a high correlation between where your investment was and where your return was. Cell phone towers scaled. The big lesson of this is that sometimes the right technology is the one that is most numerous, the one that is closest to the ground, the one that is most flexible. So why, well, now think about this in terms of drones. Think about satellites versus drones. How are we going to digitize the planet? How are we going to measure the world the way we did the web? Well, satellites are getting better. You know, SpaceX and CubeSats and things like that. But even the best of the work in satellites is only taking one order of magnitude out of the cost of satellites. Drones have the potential to take four orders of magnitude out of the cost. And that's just the start. Drones cost a few hundred dollars. Drones have unlimited resolution because they can get so close. You can take a cheap camera and put it a foot above the object, and you get the kind of resolution you could never get with an expensive camera in space. So this is the same notion. Drones are the cell phone towers to the satellite model. And because drones are intrinsically connected to the internet, you now have the ability for the internet to extend its reach out into the physical world through the Internet of Things, these sensors that are mobile, these sensors that are in place, these sensors that move, these sensors that are intrinsically connected. That's the model. It's the smartphone model, not the aerospace model. So when you think about it, we're seeing a disruption of the whole notion of Earth observation or remote sensing. What we assumed was going to be satellites and planes and drones is in fact going to be drones first, and then satellites second for the big stuff, and then maybe people won't be flying any planes at all. Maybe we won't be putting humans in harm's way because we don't need to. If all we want is the image, why are we putting humans next to the camera? Why don't we break that link between man and machine and just let the sensors fly themselves? I wanted to end with one last thought. This is my grandfather. My grandfather, Fred Hauser, a Swiss immigrant to the United States in the 1930s, he came to Hollywood, to Los Angeles, to be part of the new film industry. Back in those days, it was very mechanical. It was all about tape loops. And he was working on a company called MGM, bringing sound to movies, the talkies. And so by day, he worked on tape loops. But by night, he did exactly what you would expect a Swiss engineer in Los Angeles would do, which is, in Los Angeles, they were greening the desert. They were putting sprinklers in their backyards and growing lawns. But every night, they had to come home and turn on the sprinkler to water the lawn. And what a Swiss engineer would do is put a clock on the sprinkler, which creates an automatic sprinkler system. So he was the inventor of the automatic sprinkler system. And if you have an automatic sprinkler system, you have my grandfather to thank. But you know, I grew up, I spent my summers with him, and I realized at some point that those were robots. Those were little autonomous robots. Those automatic sprinklers are little machines that you put in place, then you forget. You just program them to do their thing, and then every day, they kind of do their one little thing. They pop up, they sprinkle water, and then they go back into the ground. And that's kind of my model for drones as well. I want our drones to be like sprinklers. I want them to just be out there in the world with their little recharging pads and their programs. And every day they go up and they do their thing. They monitor a crop, or they monitor a forest, or they scan a construction site, or they do a security perimeter. Or they monitor pipelines or wind turbines. But the point is, they just do their thing. You don't have to fly them. There's no operator. There are 1,000 to every one person who controls the fleet, maybe 1 million. The point is that they are just sensors in the sky. They are just a single-purpose robot that does one tiny thing that generates exabytes of data collectively and allows us to measure our planet, to start to close the loop on the outside world so we can start to manage it better, so we can start to be as smart about our physical world as we have been about our digital one. Thank you very much.
Chris. Hey, thanks very much, Chris. That was fantastic.
While we can talk about it, I just wanted to bring up the last slide as a kind of context for our question.
Okay. Let's
bring back put the last slide back on, please. The last slide.
Yep.
The very last slide in the deck is going to be.
In your deck.
Yeah, that's it. Exactly.
Okay. You want me to ask you, the Europe one or the hundreds?
Well, I just wanted to talk a little about the link of this conference and what we've been talking about, that you may notice that there's something familiar up there, which is this is where drones meet your cloud.
Yeah. Okay.
And you know, this is relevant to the audience because everything you're working on up there in the cloud is going to start to connect to other clouds and then these devices. It is the same architecture, the same infrastructure, the same APIs and SDKs, just extending out beyond the virtual cloud into the physical world.
Okay. All right. Well, the question I want to ask is, you know, you and I were chatting about, you know, the future 5 years, you know, what would it look like? How many drones would there be? And you said, well, every person really could have 100 drones. And I thought, wow, how can I actually control 100 drones? So how would that happen?
How do you control your sprinkler heads?
Yeah, well, we've got some, you know, one manual setup that controls.
There's a box somewhere. And you probably touched it once about 5 years ago.
Yeah.
Yep, that's the way you control your drones. That's, you know, maybe you won't be doing it, but there's fleets out there. And you know, the way I do it right now is I have an app on my phone and I tap on a building and I say I'd like a scan of that building. And then I walk away. Okay. And the drone takes off, it scans the building, it lands, that data automatically goes into the cloud. And then, you know, about 20 minutes later, it's like, bing, I get a little message that says, oh, your scan's ready, and then I just look at it.
Okay, all right, well, I'll start planning on my 100 drones. Hey, Chris, really appreciate you being here. Fantastic job.
Thanks so much.
And best of luck. All right. So our next speaker, I've known for 21 years, always interested in what he's thinking about, always interested in how he's going to express it. He's brilliant, but he has a great way of translating or relaying some of those thoughts, you know, in a very simplistic way. Without any further ado, I'd like to bring to the stage Executive Vice President and our founder of NetApp, Dave Hitz. Good evening. About 4 months ago, I had an experience that I've only had one time before in the 20 years since NetApp went public. I got a new boss. So, you know, you get a new boss. I mean, I've known George for a number of years, but now he's my boss, and plus he's in a new job. So I've been trying to figure him out, you know, what's he think like. We have a saying at NetApp: what interests my boss fascinates me. And so George is good at a lot of things. I mean, he is an out-of-the-box strategy thinker. I like his creativity. But when you spend time with a person, you start to tell what is the thing like that is the center of that person. And I will tell you, the center of George is getting things done. How do we make it happen faster? I mean, he'll be like, okay, that strategy, very interesting. What do we do tomorrow? What am I gonna measure next week? And then next week, he's like, he checks in. Did it happen? I mean, so I think that's gonna be good for NetApp. I actually think it'll be very healthy for us. There's a corollary to the saying, when I was, I ran engineering for 6 years, and once I was in my staff meeting, and I was telling my staff a story of what the CEO was interested in, and one of the guys on my staff said, what interests my boss's boss really clenches up my anus. My job is to predict the future. And I would actually argue all of our job is to predict the future. I mean, when you choose to install equipment from one vendor instead of equipment for the other vendor, you're doing that because you predicted this one would go better. Or if you're working with a customer and you recommend this configuration instead of that configuration, you're predicting. I mean, sometimes it's an easy near-term prediction, and sometimes it's a further long-term prediction. And so I'd like to share a tool that I use to think, and I shared this a year ago, but it's just my favorite tool for predicting the future. The future is already here. It's just not very evenly distributed. William Gibson is a science fiction writer. And in fact, he's the guy who invented the term cyberspace long before it happened. And here's what he means by this. What he means is whatever's going to be really common in 5 years, some crazy person somewhere is doing it already today. Right? That's the unevenly distributed part. So the lesson, here's what the lesson is not. That does not mean that you should go find a crazy person and copy them. But what I think you should do is it's useful to look at what crazy people are doing. And so here's how we constructed Insight. We looked for as many crazy people as possible, and we invited them. In some cases, we've brought them on stage. I'm going to bring one of them on stage later to do a demo. The not very evenly distributed part of that will be, we're going to demo stuff you can't buy. Or we're going to show you what we're working on in the lab. Another way to predict the future is to look at trends. And there's so many trends. I mean, they're just all over. Mobile, Internet of Things. And in some cases, NetApp can take advantage of them without really doing anything at all. I mean, anybody got a fitness watch, a Fitbit? I see three. So you are, if you've got a Fitbit, you're a NetApp customer, because the data flies up into the cloud, goes over the internet, and lands on NetApp storage. And we didn't even do anything, because it lands on NetApp storage, because it's IBM SoftLayer, and they buy NetApp. Or there's another thing, I don't know if you have it in Europe. In the US, we have, when the prisons get full, the ankle bracelet, and not all the brands, but one of the brands, the data flies up over the cloud and lands on NetApp. So here's the thing. NetApp is helping keep you thin, and we're helping make your neighborhood safe. Have you ever read a CIO magazine, and it had a list of top 10 items, and then the next year you look, and it's entirely a different list?
So here's my theory. If a trend doesn't last at least 10 years, it's not really a trend. Right? You want these ones that go on. And let me give you an example of one. In 1982, IBM introduced the PC. And it was 10 or 15, maybe even 20 years before you could just assume that anybody at work had a PC on their desk. Right? I mean, that is a 10-year trend, or in some case, multi-decade trend. So there's two trends like this that just seem especially relevant. That I believe they're long, ongoing trends for NetApp and for the data management industry. The first is Flash. I mean, Flash, it's just the price performance, the change, the speed, how it affects architectures. I mean, it is absolutely a radical change. So that's the first one, Flash. The second is cloud. And cloud actually has two pieces. The first piece is the stack of technologies that we've got, right? So server virtualization and RESTful interfaces and OpenStack and Hadoop and like Spark, all of these different things that people use for cloud. That's the technical part. But the other half of cloud, people call it the same trend, but it's almost completely different. It's this business model of cloud where instead of buying a computer, I'll just rent it over the internet and pay by the SIP. And I think that's actually the most radical shift of any of the generations of compute. I mean, we went to mainframe, AS400, Unix, Windows, Linux. Every time the question was, okay, I'm going to buy a computer. Where should I put it? How much power do I need? Who will I hire to run it? For the first time, clouds, you don't even think that way. So, and by contrast, when you look at Flash, you know, as long as the vendors put the flash in and make things go faster, then for the customer, every new generation of equipment's faster than the last and better. It's not, we can sort of hide that from the customer, the complexity of flash. There's no hiding the complexity of this business decision around cloud. In fact, I think if you sort of think about disk being the old way, disk and flash and cloud, multiple clouds, it's not a bad definition of the data fabric to say, the goal of data fabric is just to let you be whichever place, data, disk, flash, cloud, whenever you want, whichever one of those you want. Like, that's the goal of data fabric. So I'm going to talk about flash first, and then I'm going to talk about cloud. So flash. NetApp introduced very early to market with flash, and we absolutely got the right architecture. We killed it. And then we dropped the ball. We screwed up. So a lot of people don't see it that way. And then now I think we're back. So let me tell you the story of this. When we first started shipping Flash 6-7 years ago, Flash was so expensive. There were two architectural approaches. One was to build a box with nothing but Flash, and that was the most expensive box ever. And the other approach was to put a little bit of Flash in and use it as an accelerator to make it go faster. And that's the approach we took. And we nailed it. I mean, EMC took the expensive box and nobody bought it. We took the cash approach and we sold boatloads, more petabytes than anybody else, except then we dropped the ball. I have to apologize. We didn't come out with all flash. That's an example of not making a good prediction. And we opened up the door for competitors, and a lot of our partners and customers who needed that solution worked with competitors. And I just have to say, I apologize for doing that to you. But I think we're back now. I mean, if you look at the demo yesterday, if you look at the 3x performance guarantee, the pricing that we've done, I think we're back on the flash front. So cloud. Enough of flash. Cloud is complicated. It's awesome. And it's scary. I mean, the awesome part, if you're focused on CPU, cloud is especially awesome. And if you just want CPU for the weekend, I mean, it's like I can get 10,000 computers from Amazon for the weekend. It turns out if you buy them from Dell, they won't take them back. But the scary, you know, is it safe in the cloud? If I put my data in the cloud, can I get it back? Who else will look at it? Thanks to Edward Snowden, we know one other person who will look at it is the NSA, right? And then that leads to the whole question of, is it legal, which is the European safe harbor just being revoked because of the NSA. And then the final question is about lock-in. So, I mean, a lot of issues with the clouds. I'm just going to share, unrelated, I got a phone call about 4 weeks ago, and I was asked the question, would you like to have lunch with Edward Snowden, the NSA guy? And I was like, that sounds really cool, but I don't want to go to Moscow. But I got to have lunch with Edward Snowden. He showed up as a robot. Have you seen those little, it's got a base like this big around and little wheels and then two sticks and a screen at eye level? And this is true. And he has a little joystick from Russia and he can go around. And so I met with him for an hour, me and a handful of other people. So I got to introduce myself. Hi, I'm Dave Hitz. I started NetApp. And I had a question. I was really curious. I said, you know, all of that data you extracted, did any of it come off of NetApp equipment? And he gave me two answers. The first answer was, I have no comment on that. And the second answer was, there sure was a lot of NetApp gear nearby. So if that's the situation, scary, safe, legal, locked in, how can we help? You know, last year I talked about different ways that I thought we would be able to help, and what I'm so pleased with is that this year, most of the stuff that I described last year, we demoed it yesterday. Jeff and Nito did. You want to back up to the cloud? Fine, we've got the AltaVault product. A year ago, we had just announced the acquisition. You're not brave enough to put your data in the cloud? We can use NetApp private storage and put the data right next to the cloud, either Amazon or Azure, and either do a failover. I described it last year. This year, we demoed it. Or even if you want to run in the cloud, cloud ONTAP. And we've now got lots of customers doing that. And so what I feel especially pleased with is so many of those things are data related. They are about managing data, keeping track of data, moving data. The work to make the cloud work, it's NetApp's home turf. So I want to talk just briefly about how I foresee the cloud playing out. And another tool that I like to use for understanding, for predicting the future, is to look for analogies in the past. What's that saying? If you don't remember the past, you're doomed to repeat the past. And so the best analogy that I've come up with is the migration from Unix to Windows NT in the 90s. CIOs everywhere were saying, you know, we're going to switch 100% to Windows NT. We've got Unix, we're going to switch to Windows NT. 3 years, no more Unix. And there was this mass migration in, and then a mass migration back out. Not because Windows is horrible, but 20 years later, we still have, I mean, never mind Windows and Unix, we still have Unix, and we still have AS400, and some people even still have mainframe. So the point is, cloud's not going to kill all of those other things any more than any of those previous generations. It will join them as a new element in the toolkit. So the question is, how do we make all those pieces work cleanly together? And that's what I would like to demonstrate for you with Joe Caradonna. Come on out, Joe.
Hello.
Joe has been with NetApp for a long time. 17 years?
17 years this month.
And
hey, thank you.
When one of the early things Joe did at NetApp was put multiprocessor support into ONTAP. And then when we were doing the cluster work and it was time to hoist ONTAP up into a FreeBSD environment, Joe.
Yep.
And software-defined storage, getting ONTAP running in virtual machines. And so long, what are you up to today? What's your title? What do you do?
So I'm the senior technical director of our Data Fabric Engineering Group. And the thing I've been focusing on is defining and driving our technical agenda to realize the promise of our Data Fabric vision.
So let me set the stage. Yesterday, Nito and Jeff put Joel's awesome backup, his database, into an Amazon cloud. And here's our mission today. Our mission is to get it from the Amazon cloud into the Azure cloud in a usable form. And you can imagine lots of reasons why you might want to do that. But let's just say Joel's awesome database, it's like the general ledger. We suspect fraud. and we hired some data analyst, forensic guys, some accountants, but they like Azure. That's where their toolkit lives. So we got to get the data from Amazon to Azure. That's our goal. How do we start?
Want to jump into the demo?
Let's demo.
All right. So here's what we're going to do. This is on-command cloud manager, and this is our tool for managing public cloud resources.
Same thing you saw a lot of times yesterday.
Right. So we're just going to walk right
into that. But our version is different.
So a lot of capabilities we're going to show you here today. These are capabilities we have in the lab. So as Dave mentioned, you know, you can't buy this, but we're showing you the future. So
empty.
This is an empty workspace, and this is where you go to create virtual appliances in the cloud. Okay. So the first thing I'm going to do, Jeff Baxter yesterday and Neto from Brazil backed up Joel's data using an AltaVault, a physical appliance, to get it into an S3 object repository. So what we're going to create an AltaVault in the cloud, because here we have AltaVault integration with Cloud Manager. So we're going to fire that up, connect it to that bucket.
Yeah, so AltaVault is a virtual machine. Get it going.
Yeah, so let's go and do that. So here you can see where.
Select the one you got. Our list has more things than the one you buy.
And we're going to name it. I'm going to call it AVA for short on AWS. Continue that. And we select the region. So Joel's from the East Coast of the United States. So that's the region where he puts his data. Set our network configuration here. Plug in your credentials. And then you identify the bucket names. This was Joel's awesome backup.
So just what Neto typed yesterday.
Yeah.
We say Neto. You say Neto. What's that checkbox?
Well, that's just a little reminder saying, you know, as soon as you hit that go button, Amazon's going to start charging you money.
Let us give Amazon some money.
Yeah, let's spend it. Hit the go. So now we have our AltaVault appliance connected to Joel's awesome backup and Amazon.
Okay, so now I want to get the data into usable form in Azure.
Yeah, so how are we going to do that? So we've been working with Microsoft on this. So we're going to kick off Cloud ONTAP in Azure.
Cloud ONTAP in Azure. That's another one you can't have. I mean,
yeah. That's all right. We got one of you. And you name it, we're going to call this COT, Cloud ONTAP, on Azure. Now here is your data security selection. Now you can choose not to encrypt your data or encrypt your data. Now, interesting story about data encryption. Our IT organization is actually an early adopter of NetApp products.
Cynthia described that yesterday. She's always customer number one for our technology.
Yeah. And even before we ship, right, they'll evaluate the systems, they'll look at the use cases, and they'll deploy. So they looked at Cloud ONTAP, dreamed up all these wonderful use cases, and then came to the conclusion they couldn't use it for any of them. Because we have high security policies for our business data that Amazon just couldn't meet.
So you just got to keep in mind, Joe, a technical director, is admitting that he and his team designed a product that our own company could not use. Does your mom know?
Well, you know, Dave, you put it that way, it sounds bad. Yeah, no, that was true. And, you know, we had to add encryption. And it wasn't just about adding the encryption capabilities. I mean, Amazon had encryption capabilities with EBS. But it's about how you manage the keys as well.
So it turns out if you're going to keep your encryption in the cloud, you shouldn't keep your keys in the cloud, right? So that's all about
key
management.
Added support for key management servers, just like you would use on-prem. So all right, so restoring Joel's
data.
Okay, so
let's create it.
It's business critical data. We better turn
encrypt
on encryption.
Encrypt it, of
right?
course, encrypt it. I will.
Encrypt it. All right, again, East Coast. Select our network here. Credentials. Then we're going to select the storage type, and we're going to go with Azure Premium Storage.
Premium. It's Joel.
Premium. We're not messing around here. And again, you got a warning checkbox. This time, when you hit the go button, you're going to start paying
any partners.
Microsoft.
Now we're sending
money
to Azure.
Yep.
Okay, so look at this picture. It's a simple picture, but there's a lot going on. On that side, we've got the Amazon cloud. On this side, we've got the Azure cloud. On this side, we've got an AltaVault virtual machine running. On this side, we've got ONTAP running. So you've got two different data centers, two different hyperscalers, two different storage operating systems, and two different data formats. OK, so that's the situation. We want to get the data from here to there. How do we do it, Joe?
So here's what we're going to do. We're going to drag this cloud and drop it onto that cloud. Yeah.
I want you guys to think about what it is you're applauding. Because in 1984, Apple introduced drag and drop to the consumer market. And in 2015, you're applauding drag and drop. But ours does more.
And we'll get into what it's actually doing under the covers in a minute. But I should also point out, with Cloud Manager, all the operations that you can do with the GUI, well, there's a RESTful API for it. So you can automate all this yourself. So we're going to move forward in the demo here. We're going to select the volume that we want to restore. Joel's awesome volume. Yep, that's the one. And now we're going to select the snapshot that we're going to restore. And now we're going to
spend more money.
So now we have a relationship
now
between the two.
There's a line.
Which means, and you can see which direction we're moving the data to. We're transferring the data right now. You want to see that?
Yeah, let's see the data.
We're going to go into replication status. And here's our data, from one cloud to another.
So what would have had to happen if you didn't have the drag and drop? What was going on there?
So it's what we're doing under the covers here. I mean, this is, we're using Snap Mirror to get the data from AltaVault to ONTAP.
That, some people are clapping, some people aren't. That was an announcement that someday AltaVault will support the Snap Mirror protocol. It does in the lab. That's not something, you know, when you think about the data fabric, snap mirroring data from one place to another is a big part of how it works. So every time the engineers add the Snap Mirror protocol to another product, it's like it's another thread in the fabric.
Yeah, and it turns out it's really efficient for cloud use cases too, because we preserve all the storage efficiency. So your dedupe and your compression is maintained over the wire.
So. Are we done?
Yeah, we're done. So let's just check. Let's just pop into a Cloud ONTAP to keep it all honest here and look in the volume. And here's Joel's database that was restored to Cloud ONTAP.
So I kept interrupting you.
I didn't notice.
Can you just do the whole thing again?
Yeah, let's do it again. We'll speed it up this time, though. So we're drag and dropping. We're laying the foundation for a data fabric with capabilities like this.
So what occurs to me is we have made it so easy for you to take data from one data center somewhere in the world and just spray it all over the globe. And here's my question. Isn't that dangerous?
Does anyone here have a problem with that? So as we pointed out, we added encryption capabilities to the ONTAP software stack, right? We also have it for AltaVault and for our storage arrays as well. But data security goes beyond the encryption, goes beyond that, right? What you really need is visibility and control of your data, no matter where it is. You need the ability to tag, track, apply policy, and enforce policy on that data.
So like by enforce the policy, you might, like I try and drag and it says, eh. Not allowed.
Yeah, like don't let it leave the borders of my country, right? And you should be able to track what's going on too. Like what is my financial data doing in Brazil? So you can expect from us to be developing tools for you to be able to
What do you have against Brazil?
That.
You know, Nito's from Brazil.
I love Brazil. My wife is from Brazil, so I'm cool with Brazil.
Just don't want your financial data there.
Just don't want my financial data there. Yes, yeah, so we'll be developing tools to enable you to do that as we evolve our data fabric.
So I got a question for you, Joe. You have been a programmer at NetApp, sort of, you know, hardware programming on the iron, I mean, for 17 years. And then you have led, you and your team of engineers doing cloud. development, right? What does that feel like? How's it different? What have you learned doing it?
Well, it's exciting, and I'll tell you why. The cloud it's a moving target, right? And it's also one that moves quickly. And we had to adapt our engineering processes to keep pace. And we did so. So last year at Insight, George announced Cloud ONTAP. And since then, we've released two more versions of it and Cloud Manager, and we got a third on the way. AltaVault also announced here last year. And look at that platform today, and everything about it is different. OpenStack. OpenStack is a vibrant community. They pump out a new release every 6 months. And NetApp's right there building right along with
it. You shared a stat with me about OpenStack, the source we'd contributed. Share that.
Yeah, so NetApp, in this latest release of OpenStack called Liberty, NetApp contributed more code than any other vendor for both Cinder and Manila.
So we're doing a lot of work to integrate with ecosystems around.
Yeah.
So is that all you got, Joe? Anything else? That's all you've done after a year in the lab?
Yeah. So, no. I mean, we've shown you one view of the future today. But there's more to see. And right here at Insight. So engineering teams came together to prepare some demonstrations for you of things that we're doing to evolve our data fabric. Right? And again, we typically don't do this at Insight, but we're doing it for you here today. So you can go to NetApp booth and check that out. I invite you to do so.
Tomorrow morning, 9 maybe?
Yeah, after this, we're going to the party, right? Yeah. And by now, from between the sessions you've been attending and the demos you saw yesterday and what you saw here today on the stage, I hope you're starting to get a sense of what this data fabric is all about. But not only that, I hope you see the innovation behind it. Because it's the innovation as a technical director for engineering here at NetApp, it's that innovation and the passion that the engineering team brings to it, right? It's that which is what I find exciting. And I think we're building some really cool stuff here, and there's more to come.
Thank you so much.
Yep. Thank you.
So we're imagining this world where you have on-prem, you've got multiple different clouds, and you got tools to move the stuff around. And so two natural questions. Which cloud should I use? And where should I keep my data? Which doesn't necessarily need to be the same answer as which cloud to use. And so a way I like to think about the which cloud question is to talk in the context of the application lifecycle development. So if you think about applications, you first start, there's this period, you're growing, and it's just like you're developing a new app, brand new. There's another period, oh yeah, we got pictures. So first it's new, you're just inventing it, and then there's a next step where it's like, oh, somebody's using my application, and they start using it a lot, and then finally it's stable. I mean, I'm gonna have the same ERP system for the next 5 years or however long. And I believe that which stage you're in strongly determines which cloud you should use. Like during that app development stage, I mean, it's very, very common for people to use Amazon or Azure. I mean, those are just, one, you can turn them off, turn the computers on, turn them back off, there's no penalty. It's very flexible, they've got good tool sets, they're always updating the APIs. I mean, if you need it, you can get it in those clouds. It's a great place to get started. Or even if you don't start in the cloud, you can move in there. I met a customer, this was in Virginia, actually, and he just happened to have purchased Cloud ONTAP. I wasn't looking for him, but he had been at Insight last year, and he had a web development team that wanted to move to Amazon for their development. They were on-prem, and he just ran his credit card, bought Cloud ONTAP. He's a NetApp customer, so he snap-mirrored his data out to Amazon and let the web development team go. And they did their stuff, and when they wanted to bring it back, snapped it back. So, I mean, it's very easy to get going there. But I will tell you, you can get the surprise bill as you start moving into that growing phase. And let me share a story. We had a software as a service customer in Australia, and they started in Amazon, and they got to the point where they were doing 50,000 API calls an hour. And you ever get a cell phone bill and it's got a lot of lines in it? Their bill had 25 million lines. So how do you even go about understanding a bill with 25 million lines? I'll tell you what you do. You fire up an instance of Amazon Analytics. So as it starts to grow, you may want to work with a different cloud that has a different billing model. Maybe somebody that sets a set limit on how much service you'll get and also a set price. Or maybe somebody who understands enterprise relationships better, like a telco, or maybe there's a regional VAR, or maybe there's legal issues. And so you have to work during development, it's all fake data, but during production, perhaps it needs to be an internet service provider in your own country, might be what the law is, depending on the kind of data. And then, you know, finally, that's the growing phase. But when it stabilizes and you're like, I do know exactly what this app's going to be like for the next 5 years, maybe it would make more sense to capitalize it or to go into a hosting kind of a scenario. So I really see the cloud changes over time, which is why it's so important to have tools to let you be flexible. Now, the second question is, where should my data live? And, you know, if you've got a small amount of data, relatively small, it's something like a financial database, we can do the user interface to make it drag and drop, make it very easy to move that data. But if it's a lot of data, there's no user interface that can simplify it. And let me give you an example of this. I had a customer that they had let 8 petabytes of data accumulate in one of the hyperscalers. And they concluded that was not the best long-term strategy, so they put together a project to get to the 8 petabytes out. And let me tell you about the project. Given the bandwidth they could get, it took 3 months to get the data out, with the bandwidth running, with the virtual machines fired up to get the data out, and it was $600,000 per month. So I'm not saying that's a bad deal. In fact, you know, who knows? Maybe they were a small company and they didn't have the cash to buy equipment and they went public, right? And so they used the money from going public to, maybe it was an awesome deal for them. Here's my point though. You should not let data accumulate randomly in the cloud. If you're letting, it's so easy to let it pile up. If you're letting data accumulate, make sure you know that that's your strategy for it to be there and what it would take to get it out. So it may well be that NetApp private storage, you know, earlier I described NetApp private storage as a good solution. So put your storage next to the cloud, you buy the box, put it next to Amazon or Azure. I described that as a solution maybe because you're afraid to go into the cloud. It may well be that for some types of data, big piles of data, that's the best permanent spot for it. Remember the demo that Nito and Jeff did? How long does it take to fail over from Azure to Amazon? 5 seconds! I love this company. So, and that's true whether it's 10 terabytes or 10 petabytes. So that may be the best place to let data pile up. It's kind of cool. I'm the founder of NetApp. And so people ask me these questions. You know, they ask me questions like, why are you still here? What's your job? How does it feel knowing there's 12,000 people in your company? What's it like to grow a company like that, to build a company like that? And they say it that way. Anybody in here have kids? Did you build them? Can you control them? So here's the thing, when I think about what's a good relationship between a parent and a child, I'm just happy NetApp even will still talk to me. And occasionally listen to something I say. It's awesome. So another question I get a lot, I talk to customers and customers ask me this question, should I go into the cloud? And here's my answer, and you can quote me on this. I don't know. I think this is a really important ending to a talk about predicting the future. Because you have to admit, people who do good predictions are well aware of the uncertainty in what they're doing, right? That you don't know the answer. You're guessing, you're working, and especially the question, should a customer move into the cloud? I don't know your business. I don't know how much money you have in the bank. I don't know what your competitive landscape is. I mean, I'm happy to talk with you about it and share ideas. And like I said, the reason we invited so many people at the forefront of cloud computing to this show is to help you talk to them and figure out, am I like that person? And so I need to do what they're doing, or maybe I'm nothing like that person. I don't want to do what they're doing. That's how you figure it out. But here's what I do know. I know for sure that for NetApp, the right answer is to push fast towards the cloud. Not because we're encouraging you to go there. I mean, if you want to, that's great, you should. But we have to go there because we need to be there so that when you're ready, you'll know you can trust us to help you get there. That's the point of what we're doing up here. So, and you know what? For some of you, it may not be for 5 years. And for other ones of you, you'll be like, we were the guys, well, I'm crazy, you invited me, right? But the thing is, if we don't do that, we're doomed. If we do that, what's so cool about the place NetApp is at is that the things we're doing with data are exactly what the world needs in order to get into cloud computing. I was talking with the chief technology officer of Rackspace, and he told me, here's how they think about, they're a cloud provider hosting, and he said, our goal is to automate everything. We'll automate provisioning of new application stack, automate provisioning of new storage, automate provisioning of new CPU. He said, even performance management debugging, that's harder to automate. Our goal is to automate everything. But he said, in the end, the one thing you can't automate away is the data. And so here's my theory of business. If there's something customers want to do, get to the cloud, and it's hard, and we've got really smart people working on it. I don't know all the details. I'm not sure which of the products we've showed will be the real hits and which, like, no, we've got to go invent some more. But I know for sure, together we can figure out how to make the cloud work and make a business out of it. So thank you all so much for being here at Insight. Really appreciate it. Okay.
All right, we're almost done here. Hey, this one thing you can always count on, Dave delivers, so thank you very much, Dave. All right, so we're just gonna do a little recap here, general session. Number one, we did it. We raised $7,000. Thank you very much. Congratulations. So what did we see? We had George, Rob, and Joel all share the vision of Data Fabric. We heard our partners talk about how they're engaged with our vision and how they see the value. And then we saw customers talk about how they're making it real today, making Data Fabric real today. We saw some amazing demos. You just saw the one from Dave and Joe. We saw Nito and Jeff yesterday. So we saw today, saw a little taste of the future. And obviously, fantastic keynotes from our guest speaker, Chris Anderson, and from our founder, Dave Hitz. Now, there's a very critical component of general session that we should talk a little bit about, and that's you, but we're gonna come back to that. Because I need to introduce one more person to stage, because he's my boss. So Tom Gerstenberger is Executive Vice President of Field Ops, which at NetApp means basically he's responsible for the entire sales and SE team and making sure we know what we're doing, and we're out in front of customers, and we're delivering value to them, solving problems, working with them, making great things happen. He also happens to know how to dress for a party. So please help me welcome Tom to the stage.
Hey, Roger.
Tom, thanks.
Thanks, Roger.
You look great.
You know, I've never talked to an audience this large wearing leather pants. But really, before we start thanking, you know, everybody, I want to make sure we recap kind of what we've seen this week. You know, we've had a couple of great days here in Berlin. You know, personally, I've had some exciting conversations with customers, great interactions with our partner community. And I'm always thrilled to get our tech team together and just kind of be awed by the power of the innovation that they describe as they learn and get certified. That kind of rhymed. You know, you've experienced how we've unlocked the value of data fabric, how we're enabling those great customer outcomes, whether it's advancing the way we bring medicine to places, pharma companies that are taking drugs, getting them into the marketplace very quickly, that are actually having great efficacy in treating diseases that have eluded us for years, or actually predicting weather, as we saw on the epic story. So, you know, this is a terrific time to be in technology. We really are in the digital age. And the pace of change that we're all facing, whether it's in our own companies or in companies that are putting technology together to unlock amazing value. So, an event like Insight can't happen without a lot of people. So I want to have you all join me in thanking the NetApp team, our vendors, CityCube, the caterers, all the people that come together to make this happen. Can you please join me in a round of applause?
Absolutely. Woo!
For our customers in the audience, I hope that we've demonstrated our commitment to your success. For our partners, I thank you for your continued investment in NetApp. And we truly appreciate the collaboration and the partnership that you've done with us over the years. I hope you are as inspired as I am by what we're experiencing over the last 3 days. And I hope you'll join us in building the NetApp data fabric together.
All right. Thank you, Tom. Very good. You know, for me, I have a really tremendous sense of pride about what we've done with Insight over the years, and, you know, echo everything Tom said about everybody who made this event special. It's been an honor for me to be the host over the last 3 days here, but now it's really time to party. But it seems like we're missing something. I mean, we have lederhosen on.
Dressed up.
I have a clicker in my hand. It seems like there should be something else.
Music.
No, yeah, music and and beer. Oh.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
All right, so for everyone, please be sure to join us down at the attendee appreciation event at Tempelhof. That starts at 7:30 in Hangar 6. Be sure you get your wristbands from Gift Redemption on the entrance level downstairs. Buses are leaving from hotels starting at 7 p.m. Check your mobile app. And
thank you, everyone. And we will see you here next year. Prost!
Prost!